Burns, an update on current pharmacotherapy. Propranolol, a nonspecific beta-1, beta-2 adrenergic receptor antagonist that has been studied extensively, holds promise for reduction of the post-burn hypermetabolic response. Reduction of cardiac work with administration of propranolol. Infusion of 2 mg/kg/day propranolol for 5 days showed that this short duration of therapy diminishes tachycardia and reduces cardiac work without affecting the re-resting energy expenditure. Administering low doses of propranolol, 0.5 to 1.0 mg/kg, to severely burned patients reduces myocardial oxygen requirements without adversely affecting oxygen delivery. When titrated at a dose to reduce heart rate by 10 to 20% of baseline for more than 10 days, propranolol continues to safely reduce cardiac workload in severely burned children. Patients initially treated with 1 mg/kg/day propranolol to reduce the heart rate to 15% of the admission heart rate required a dose escalation to 4 mg/kg/day within 10 days to sustain the goal heart rate and treatment benefits of decreased cardiac work. Long-term propranolol use in severely burned pediatric patients has revealed that a decrease in heart rate of 15% below admission heart rate and a subsequent decrease in cardiac work is maintained with an average dose of 4 mg/kg/day, when given every 6 hours or once daily as an extended-release formulation for 12 months. Given the safety of propranolol at 4 mg/kg/day, increasing the dose to further decrease cardiac work could be considered in severely burned patients. In burn patients, peripheral lipolysis is increased through the activation of beta-2 adrenergic receptors by catecholamines. This results in substantial fatty infiltration of the liver. By way of beta-2 adrenergic blockade, propranolol inhibits liberation of free fatty acids from adipose tissue, increases the efficiency of the liver in excreting fatty acids, and in turn decreases burn-induced hepatic steatosis plasma. Triglycerides are also significantly lower in these patients. Long-term administration of propranolol at 4 mg/kg/day is associated with maintenance of peripheral fat mass, and consequently no change occurs in central fat mass. Beta blockade with propranolol reduces breakdown of peripheral muscle and increases protein synthesis. Children with burns over 40% of the TBSA receiving an average daily dose of propranolol of 2 to 6 mg/kg/day had a net muscle protein balance increase of 82% above baseline. Propranolol may increase net protein balance and decrease overall lean mass catabolism by preventing skeletal muscle necrosis after severe burn injury. Smaller amounts of insulin are needed to reduce elevated glucose levels after burn in propranolol-treated patients. Administration of propranolol at 5 mg/kg/day orally immediately post-burn attenuates the hepatic endoplasmic reticulum ER stress response and increases insulin sensitivity. The role of propranolol in the treatment of burn injuries goes beyond modulating metabolism. Both local and systemic administration of propranolol have been shown to enhance wound healing and decrease the surface area requiring skin grafting. With reduced mortality from the acute injury, the emphasis of burn care has shifted to improving morbidity and optimizing rehabilitation. Given that approximately one-third of burn victims suffer from acute and post-traumatic stress disorder, the use of psychotropic agents in the burn population is common. The use of propranolol as a potential psychotropic agent is being explored. Insulin. Burn patients receiving insulin infusions, 1.5 U/kg/min to maintain 100 to 140 mg/dl blood glucose, and a high carbohydrate/protein diet, 1,500 kilocalories per square meter plus 1,500 kilocalories per square meter burned every 14 hours, exhibit improvements in LBM lean body mass, bone mineral density, and length of hospitalization. Intensive insulin treatment to maintain blood glucose between 80 and 110 mg/dl during the acute hospitalization period results in decreased infectious episodes, sepsis, organ dysfunction, and insulin resistance, and it improves mitochondrial oxidative capacity. Because of the risk of hypoglycemia, infusions of insulin do require close monitoring and are of no use in the outpatient setting. Anti-hyperglycemic therapeutics, fenofibrate, metformin, GLP-1 agonists, and SS31. Metformin, glucophage, ubiquinide, has been widely used to correct hyperglycemia in diabetic patients and is currently an alternative drug for treatment of injury-induced hyperglycemia. Metformin targets the metabolic process underlying hyperglycemia in critical illness, inhibiting gluconeogenesis and augmenting insulin sensitivity in the periphery. In addition to reducing hyperglycemia, metformin speeds muscle protein formation and increases the net protein balance in muscle. Metformin appears to have effects analogous to insulin in critically injured patients and is a promising alternative given its safety record in the outpatient setting. Although lactic acidosis has been reported with administration of metformin and other biguanides, this side effect has not been reported in preliminary trials of this drug in severely burned patients. However, patients should be monitored for this development as recommended. Thus, the biguanide drugs should be used with caution as a replacement therapy for insulin. Fenofibrate brand names: Enthera, Fenaglide, Lipofen, Tricer, Triglide, Lipidyl Micro, DOM Fenofibrate, Lipidyl Supra, Lofibra, Lipidyl Easy. Fenofibrate not only ameliorates hyperglycemia and insulin resistance, but also improves wound healing in severely burned patients. Clinical trials evaluating the effects of long-term use in burn patients are now underway. Mitochondrial oxidative function in skeletal muscle appears to be impaired in patients with insulin resistance, such as type 2 diabetics. Furthermore, severe burn injury also causes mitochondrial dysfunction, which may contribute to insulin resistance after burns. In a randomized control trial of fenofibrate, A peroxisome proliferator activated receptor alpha. Agonist, significant reduction of plasma glucose was achieved without inducing hypoglycemia. Administration of this drug to burned children for 2 weeks reduces insulin resistance. SS31 elamipretide, also known as SS31 and Bendavia, reduce the production of toxic reactive oxygen species and stabilize cardiolipin. Other approaches to targeting mitochondrial dysfunction targets include the use of SS31, an antioxidant peptide. Studies in thermally injured mice have shown promising improvements in insulin resistance with the use of SS31. These studies suggest that SS31 may be of benefit in the treatment of post-burn insulin resistance. Other ongoing approaches to reduce hyperglycemia after burn injury include the use of glucagon-like peptide, GLP-1 agonist semaglutide, Ozempic. GLP-1 suppresses glucagon, stimulates insulin secretion, and therefore, decreases serum blood glucose. Approved GLP agonists: exenatide, Byetta, Bydureon. Approved in 2005/2012. Liraglutide, Victoza, Saxenda. Approved 2010. Lixizenatide, Lixumia. Approved in 2016/9. Albiglutide, Tanzoom. Approved in 2014. Dulaglutide, Trulicity, approved in 2014, manufactured by Eli Lilly. 11. Semaglutide, Ozempic, approved in 2017. Under investigation GLP agonists: Taspaglutide, phase 3 halted SEP 2010. Ketoconazole 200-400 mg/Deponazoral in Cushing syndrome 600-800 mg/Depo. The administration of ketoconazole successfully blocked cortisol production but did not affect whole body catabolism in severely burned patients. Additionally, no alterations were reported in the post-burn inflammatory response, RE, hormones, acute phase proteins, or sex steroids. These results suggest that hypercortisolemia may not play an important role in the post-burn hypermetabolic catabolic response as once believed. Side effect: liver failure, nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, urticaria, pruritus, insomnia, nervousness, CNS disorders, photophobia, orthostatic hypotension, myalgia, menstrual disorder, asthenia, fatigue, hot flush, malaise, edema peripheral, pyrexia, chills, hepatotoxicity, anaphylaxis, decreased testosterone levels, TORS aids de points, may be fatal. Testosterone and oxandrolone. Testosterone production is greatly decreased after severe burn injury. Testosterone administration makes the use of intracellular amino acids that are derived from protein catabolism more efficient and leads to an overall increase in protein synthesis. Restoring serum testosterone in severely burned males significantly decreases breakdown of muscle and improves protein synthesis. Oxandrolone, an analog of testosterone that has lower androgenicity and is well absorbed when administered orally, is a more favorable option, particularly for women and prepubescent boys. Stimulating protein synthesis and anabolism. During amino acid infusions, the use of oxandrolone significantly speeds protein catabolism without affecting the rate of protein breakdown. Several doses, 0.05, 0.1, and 0.2 mg/kg/day, have been tested in the pediatric burn population, with improvements associated with each dose. The combination of a 12-week resistive and aerobic exercise program with the administration of RHGH, 0.05 mg/kg/day, provided an increase in muscle strength and aerobic capacity. Furthermore, RHGH has been noted to cause hyperglycemia in severely burned patients when administered at 0.2 mg/kg/day. Lower doses of 0.05 mg/kg/day did not lead to hyperglycemia.